Now we come to the second part in our probability section, module 6, the first part of module 6. We're going to look at some basic probability rules. And we're going to start out with some probability facts that you can count on and take to the bank every single time. The first big one is that the probability of any event will never be negative and will never be greater than 1. This can be really important as you're working through problems because sometimes mistakes are made. And if you ever end up with a decimal that's negative or a decimal that's greater than 1, then you know something went wrong within that process. So your probability will always be between 0 and 1. In your, if you're talking about percentage, it'll always be between 0 and 100%. Also, the probability that the outcome will be from our sample space is 1. This goes back to our definition of sample space in our last video, where we said that the sample space contains every possible outcome of a probability trial or experiment. Symbolically, the way we represent this is the probability of S, that it'll come from my sample space, is equal to 1. This is going to come into play in our next concept. It's impossible also that something outside of our sample space will occur. If my sample space is correct, it contains every possible outcome. Symbolically, we could represent this by the probability of the empty set is equal to 0. It cannot, we cannot pick something from outside of our sample space. This leads us into our first rule, which is a very important rule and a very useful rule as we go forward, and it's called the complement rule. Since events are a subset of the larger set of outcomes within our sample space, for any event E, its complement, we represent with EC. Sometimes we also, you'll see on the next block, that sometimes it's represented with not E. So if we have an event E, its complement would be that E does not occur, or E's complement. It consists of all the outcomes that are not in the space for our event. For example, if our event is rolling an even number, we'd first want to look at our sample space. Our sample space occurs, our sample space contains every possible outcome on a six-sided die, so 1 through 6. We can represent our event, which is rolling an even number, as a smaller set of this bigger set. So the big rectangle here represents our sample space. And if you're ever drawing a Venn diagram, you want to first draw out a rectangle to represent all your possible outcomes. And then within that, we can list our outcomes, and this becomes a smaller subset of that. The event's complement, then, is everything that's not inside that circle, so everything that lies on the outside of the circle, which in this case is the rolls 1, 3, and 5, the odd numbers. If we take the event and we add to it its complement, we get our sample space. So literally, the event, all the outcomes that are in our event, plus all the outcomes that make up its complement, equals the total number of outcomes in our sample space. E plus event's complement is equal to our sample space. If we take on that idea and attach probability to each of these events, we can also say that the probability that our event occurs plus the probability our event does not occur is equal to the probability that our event comes from our sample space. And as we saw on the first slide, the probability that it comes from my sample space is equal to 1. So therefore, here is our complement rule. For any event E, the probability that E will occur is equal to 1 minus the probability that it won't occur. In other words, we took this formula and just subtracted the probability of the event's complement to the other side. So the probability that any event occur will occur equals 1 minus the probability the event does not occur. The reason why this is such a helpful idea is that sometimes it's easier for us to find the probability of an event not occurring than it is to try to figure out all the ways it could occur. Because a lot of times there's just too many to count. One example that we can pull up from the previous lesson was that we looked at the sample space of rolling two die, right? So if you remember that big sample space we had of 36 possible outcomes, we looked at how many outcomes comprised the event doubles. So here we're looking for the probability that the dice will not be a doubles. So here's how we define E. E, my event, is not doubles. And so its complement would be that we would get doubles. We saw that there were six ways that we could get doubles. So the probability that our event doesn't occur, that we get doubles, is 6 out of 36, which is 1/6. And so therefore, the probability we won't get doubles is going to be 1 minus that, 1 minus 1/6, or 5/6. Again, we could turn that into a decimal and or a percentage if we so desired. So let's look at the next rule for probability, and that is the DISJOINT rule for probability. This is the DISJOINT rule for probability applies when we're calculating the probability of multiple events or multiple outcomes occurring for a single trial. For example, let's say our single trial is pulling a card out of a deck of cards, one single card. So we've got one trial. What is the probability that our card is either a queen or a nine? I have the or in bold here because or is a very important rule. When you see or, you want to think of this addition rule. In this case, we have deemed two possible outcomes as being successful outcomes for our experiment. Either it's a queen or it's a nine. So if we look at the number of cards we have for each, there are four queens and there are also four nines. So we have a total of eight cards in the deck that would be considered successful for this probability trial. 4 out of 52 plus 4 out of 52 gives me 8 cards out of 52 that would be successful outcomes, which is approximately a 15% probability. If we write this out symbolically, we can see the addition rule in effect. The probability of one event plus the probability of a second event equals the probability that either this or that event occurs. Now, does this apply all the time? In general, we can say it does, but as you see in our next example, there are exceptions. For example, if we were looking at the probability that we were going to pick a king or a heart, again, write this out symbolically, if we counted out our kings, there's, well, four kings in a deck of cards, and if we look at the number of hearts, there's 13 cards that are hearts. Based on the previous example, we might falsely assume that 4 out of 52 plus 13 out of 52 gives me the probability of this event. But if we actually looked at the number of cards in that deck of cards that were successful outcomes, there's only 16. Why is that? Well, unfortunately, we counted the King of Hearts twice. In this particular case, we have some overlapping outcomes that we can kind of see from this picture here. We have our kings, and then we have our hearts. But because of this overlap, this means that there is one card that we might mistakenly count twice, and that's the King of Hearts. We counted that King of Hearts when we counted up our kings, and we counted it again when we counted the hearts. So we do have to adjust our formula a little bit. We're going to see this on the next slide. When we have overlapping outcomes, we say those events are disjoint. I'm sorry, I said that incorrectly. Here's a picture of our first scenario. A and B are disjoint if they don't have any overlapping outcomes. So when we were looking at the queen or a nine, these are examples of disjoint events. They do not overlap. They have no outcomes that are in common. In our second example, we saw a situation where we had two events that were not disjoint, meaning they had overlapping outcomes, and therefore we have to be careful in our counting. and we're going to see how we can adjust our formula to meet that scenario. Again, these are pictures of Venn diagrams. The rectangles represent our sample space, all possible outcomes, and these circles represent our smaller events that we've defined. Two events that do not overlap are called disjoint events. And so for two disjoint events, the probability that either one or the other occurs is equal to the sum of their probabilities. But if we don't have disjoint events, or events are not disjoint, then they overlap. And so we throw this little extra part here on the end. This takes it back to where it needs to be. This, we can interpret it. Now you'll notice that the word and is here. With the word and, that means these two things occur at the same time. For our previous example, if I were to apply this formula to it, we have the probability of king plus the probability of getting a heart minus the probability that king and hearts is drawn at the same time, meaning we picked the king of hearts. There's only one way that can occur, so if I take the probability of that picking that one card, we subtract the overlap that we counted twice over here. Notice that that picking the king of hearts is not an unsuccessful outcome. We just counted it twice, and so if we subtract it once, then we've subtracted out that extra count we made in the first addition part. And with that, we get 16 out of 52, which is the correct probability for this experiment. So in this formula with the ORs, I want you to keep in mind that the context of this subtraction that we do here is this is representing the probability that they occur at the same time on my one trial or experiment that I'm performing. That concludes this lesson.